In this video, I will explain how to manage in DaVinci Resolve CinemaDNG RAW footages coming from MLV files. Just now, I'm filming with the Canon EOS M, and the image that you are looking now was color graded using the workflow I'm gonna explain. With Magic Lantern installed, our Canon cameras generate MLV files. MLV stands for Magic Lantern Video. Using any MLV app, we extract the raw video data from the MLV container and save it in a separate file in raw format like CinemaDNG to be able to use it in DaVinci Resolve. Now, what color space is and why it's so important to know how to manage it in DaVinci Resolve? The color space is a numerical interpretation of the way a camera captures colors or the way a display shows colors. DaVinci Resolve, through the correct management of the color, help us to transform what the camera saw into what our display can reproduce. We film something in a big raw scene state, and then we have to shape it into a reproduction state with DaVinci Resolve.
So, a scene referred workflow is one in which we manipulate our images prior to their transformation from camera color space to display color space. While a display referred workflow is one in which we manipulate our images after they have been transformed from camera color space to display color space.
Most of RAW videos are not encoded with a specific color space, and this is the case of the Canon cameras that use Magic Lantern. So we have to be creative and we have to find a way to manage these files in DaVinci Resolve. There is no workflow that is better than another, but there is a way of working that gives us more control options to achieve the best result when we make our color grading.
My shot sample was filmed in 4:2K, 14-bit, 16:9 aspect ratio, using the latest Magic Lantern build known as Crop Mode. You can download it from the link I put in the description. Let's go to the project settings. There are different options to do this conversion from what our camera sees to what our display can reproduce. All these options are valid. We have DaVinci YRGB non-managed, DaVinci Color managed, and Assist. In this video, we are going to use the DaVinci non-managed method using what we call the CST color space transform. The most common output color space, especially for online deliverables, is Rec. 709 Gamma 2.4. In my case, because I use a Mac and my display is connected directly to my laptop via USB-C, I will use Rec. 709A to be sure that what I see is what I deliver. For the moment, we leave our timeline color space as default to Rec. 709. When we import CinemaDNG files in DaVinci Resolve and we set our color science to DaVinci YRGB non-managed, if we look at our camera raw tab, DaVinci, depending on what decode method is selected, automatically and by default set the input color space and gamma. For example, if we use project as decode method, our input color space and gamma will be Rec. 709 and sRGB. If we select CinemaDNG default, color space and gamma will be both Rec. 709. So, to take control over it, we have to select decode using clip. Doing that will unfold all the raw controls and we'll be able to set the color space and gamma that we want. We have three options of color space: Rec. 709, D3D60, and Blackmagic Design. As input gamma, we can choose between Rec. 709, Rec. 709 2.4, Rec. 709 2.6, sRGB, and linear.
So, what input color space and gamma we have to choose for our CinemaDNG files? As we said previously, most raw videos data are not encoded with a specific color space, so we need to find the best possible starting point for our clip. Somewhat reasonable for our display with healthy level of contrast and saturation, something closer to what I saw in camera when I shoot.
So, in my edit tab, I'm going to duplicate a few times the clip. Returning to my color tab, here are my clips. I'm gonna set the color space and gamma of my first clip as Rec. 709 sRGB, my second clip as Rec. 709 Rec. 709, and I'll set the last two clips using the two most popular settings in the Magic Lantern community. Color space P3D60, gamma linear, and color space and gamma Blackmagic Design. If we look each clip, each one is different from the other. Now that we have set our supposed input color space, let's create a color space transform node, CSD node for each clip, to transform our clip from our camera color space to our display color space. So in the first clip in our CSD node, we add the color space transform plugin, which is included in DaVinci Resolve. As input color space and gamma, we'll select those that we set in our RAW tab. In this case, Rec 709 and sRGB. As output color space and gamma, we'll select those that match our display color space for the correct reproduction. In my case, Rec 709 and Rec 709A. I'll do the same for each clip, only changing the input color space and gamma set in my RAW tab, and leaving the output color space and gamma unchanged. So, this is our second clip with input color space and gamma Rec 709. Our third clip, the 3D60 linear. And our fourth clip, Blackmagic Design Film, and in our node, Blackmagic Design Gen 1, Blackmagic Design Film. If we look at the images, the sRGB and P3D60 clips are almost identical. The Rec 709-709 image is more contrasted, but it happens because DaVinci applies automatically OOTF opto-optical transform function to convert from scene to display referred. I already explained what scene and display referred means. So we only have to apply this conversion manually because DaVinci interprets sRGB and P3D60 as display referred and not as scene referred. Now the three clips are almost identical. The only that look different is the one which has as input color space Blackmagic. At this point, we could easily make some basic adjustment to this clip to take it to a more natural and pleasing look using the RAW tab controls and export it. But we can do better. Let's reset the changes. I'm gonna explain the workflow using the clip with Rec 709 color space and gamma, but it's the same for all the clips. I create a new node which I label CSD in, and for the moment I turn off my previous CSD node. What I'm gonna do now is add a color space transform in my CSD node, choosing as input color space Rec 709 and gamma Rec 709. And instead of sending it to Rec 709 display color space, this time I'll send it in an intermediate color space. Output color space DaVinci White Gamut, output gamma DaVinci Intermediate. I changed the tone mapping method from DaVinci to none. This way I avoid anywhere clipping lights. As we can see now, our image is in a log state. Now I turn on my previous CSD node, and because we came from DaVinci White Gamut, I change my input color space to DaVinci White Gamut and my input gamma to DaVinci Intermediate. My final color space display remains the same, 709. This time I change the tone mapping method to luminance. I'm gonna label this node CSD out. At this point we have an input color space and an output color space. We have a third color space too, which is our working color space and is located between our two nodes. If we go to our project settings, DaVinci calls it Timeline Color Space. We have to set it as DaVinci White Gamut Intermediate. Now we can do all the adjustment of our color inside a really large working color space container, which is DaVinci White Gamut. And once we have done that, we can then output it into Rec 709. As example, I'm gonna create four nodes in my working space, and I do a simple basic correction. In my first node, I raise my exposure using the global HDR wheel. Then I add some contrast. and balance the image just for the skin tones using the global HDR wheel. We can see how the skin tone is aligned with the skin line in the vectorscope. And finally, I add some saturation using again my global HDR wheel. Before, after. Now I will apply this adjustment to my other clips with different input color spaces. This is my Rec 709 sRGB. This is Rec 709, and this is P3 D60 linear. As you can see, the three clips are almost identical. The P3 D60 has the shadow slightly more opened. With this workflow, it doesn't matter what color space and gamma you choose from those available in the RAW tab. Only our clip with Blackmagic input color space is different, but we can do some little adjustment to get a good result. Now, how can I add a LUT? With this workflow, it's very easy. Depending on the LUT I want to use, I only have to change the output color space and gamma of my output CST node to the correct color space and gamma of the camera for which the LUT was created. Let's see how. I'll do it with my second clip, Rec 709. For example, if I want to apply a film print emulation like the Kodak 2383, I only change in my CST out node the output color gamma to Cinion Film Log. Then I add a serial node where I apply the LUT and choose a Kodak 2383 LUT. Now I can make some adjustment underneath my CST out node. For example, lowering the exposure. If we want to add a phantom LUT made for the Sony S-Log profile, I change in my CST out node the output color space to Sony S-Gamma 3 and the output gamma to Sony S-Log 3. Then in my LUT node, I can choose any phantom LUT for the Sony S-Log profile, like this Eterna Film emulation. And again, I can do some change, like for example, raising the saturation. The advantage of using a workflow like this is simply that no matter what camera clips you put in this pipeline, you are always going to work in the same DaVinci intermediate working huge color space, and so the controls are going to feel always the same for any camera. This is a more advanced color grading of our clip. The original clip, the corrected clip. This is the clip Rec 709 sRGB. This is the clip Rec 709. And this is the clip P3 D60 linear. I only changed the input color space and gamma in my RAW tab and first CST node. The three clips are almost the same. No matter what color space and gamma you choose in your RAW tab. Recently, I'm using as input color space and gamma Rec 709 because it gives me good results. The most important thing is get a good starting point for your image. So this is all for the moment. See you soon.